Have you ever seen a movie where someone runs down a hallway firing a gun like it has no impact on them? That turns out to be totally unrealistic. It ignores the kickback or recoil that happens when you fire a gun. It turns out that when you fire something forward, it pushes you backward. Why is that? Well, it all has to do with the conservation of momentum. Remember, momentum is that whole mass times velocity thing. And it turns out momentum is always conserved. So if I push something forward, it pushes me backward with the equal and opposite effect. Let's learn all about conservation of momentum. Let's begin by looking at our lesson objectives. First, we'll review the properties of momentum. Most importantly, we'll review the conservation of momentum. Then we'll apply conservation of momentum to a collision. We'll see how this principle helps us understand collisions. Then we'll apply conservation of momentum to propulsion. Propulsion means getting something moving, and we'll see that conservation of momentum helps us understand this in many cases as well. All right, let's review momentum. First up, recall that momentum is a vector. That means it has a direction. And momentum points in the direction of motion. In the case of this comet, momentum would be pointing directly towards its direction of motion. Also remember that momentum is conserved. And what that means is that momentum is not created and that momentum is not destroyed. We can express that mathematically as P sub F equals P sub I. Remember that P means momentum. This is saying that the final momentum is equal to the initial momentum. This is where we're going to start all the problems in this lesson. So it's really important that we see that conservation of momentum mathematically is PF equals PI, and we can do tons of cool stuff with this seemingly simple equation. Here we can see a nice example of the conservation of momentum. The metal sphere on one side is lifted up and then let go. That momentum is passed through each sphere through a series of collisions. And we see that on the far side, the ball rises to about the same height as it did before, because momentum is conserved. Let's apply this principle to collisions. We can solve problems like this. A cue ball with a momentum of 1.87 kilograms meters per second collides with the second pool ball and comes to rest. What is the velocity of the second ball if its mass is 0.15 kilograms? Let's go ahead and solve for the velocity of this second ball. The key equation we're going to use is conservation of momentum, which says that the momentum initial is equal to the momentum final. Now, remember, at the beginning, only the cue ball is moving, so the initial momentum is all about the cue ball. Meanwhile, the final momentum is when only that second ball is moving, so it's all about the second ball. Okay? Now we know the initial momentum, and what we want to find is the final velocity. Recall, just like our problem states, that momentum is equal to mass by velocity. So we can rewrite this as momentum initial equals mass times velocity, where that mass is the mass of the second ball, and that velocity is the velocity of the second ball. So now we have our equation we're going to use, and let's go ahead and write down each of these variables. So we know momentum initial is 1.87 kilograms, and we also know that our mass is 0.150 kilograms. What we don't know is our velocity of that second ball there eventually. So let's solve this by plugging in what we know to our equation, and we'll get 1.87 equals 0.15 times velocity. And now all we have to do to solve for velocity is divide both sides by 0.15. That's going to give us velocity all by itself on the right, because those will cancel out. And 1.87 divided by 0.15 is going to give us 12.46 and some other digits as well. We want to round that for our sig figs. And here notice that we have, in fact, three sig figs in our momentum initial, 1, 2, 3, and three sig figs in our mass, 1, 2, 3. So we need to round this to 3 sig figs. So we'll keep 1, 2, and this guy. The 4 is going to round up because of the 6, and we'll get 12.5. Now, what are the units there? Well, recall that the velocity units in our momentum equation have to be meters per second. So what we know now is from the momentum of the pool ball, initially, we can actually solve for the velocity of the second ball it hits. That's one application of conservation of momentum. Let's move on to the second application of conservation of momentum, propulsion, which just means getting something moving. Here, the space shuttle is moving towards outer space by pouring out hot gases down towards the Earth. Conservation of momentum actually demands that there be an upward force then on this space shuttle, pushing it to outer space. How does that work exactly? Well, let's take a look at a smaller, more terrestrial rocket to get an understanding of this process. Check it out. It's a water bottle rocket. This 2-liter bottle is pouring out high-pressured water, and that's driving it upwards, launching it. And what we want to ask here is, what is the momentum before launch? Well, before it moves at all, it has to have a momentum of 0. So the momentum initial must be 0. And then it launches. Water pours out the bottom, and the bottle goes up. Okay, but what is the momentum after the launch? Well, here we have to be very careful. We have to realize what we're asking about is not the momentum of the bottle or the momentum of the water, but the momentum of both. And the momentum of the bottle is positive, while the momentum of the water shooting out the bottom is negative. Well, what's the momentum altogether after the launch? Well, if before the launch it was 0, after the launch it has to be 0 too. And that's the key. That's what makes conservation of momentum work for launching things. Because the momentum downwards and upwards have to be equal and opposite to maintain that 0 momentum. Let's actually go ahead and solve a problem with this water bottle. This problem says a 2-liter water bottle with a mass of 0.250 kilogram expels 1.2 kilograms of water at a velocity of 2.2 meters per second. What is the upward velocity of the water bottle? Let's go ahead and solve for the velocity of this water bottle. We're going to have to work to develop an equation to use, but don't worry, in the future, we're going to give you equations like these so that you can solve problems like this. And we're going to do a ton more practice problems. So if this seems like a lot, don't stress. You'll get caught up as you go through a few videos. We're going to start with the momentum conservation equation, which tells us that momentum initial is equal to momentum final. We've already said that momentum initial is 0 because the bottle and the water were at rest to begin with, and that tells us momentum eventually, in the final case, will also be 0. That momentum final is 0 even though both the water and the bottle will be moving at the end. And so if we want to think carefully about that final momentum, we need to write it as the sum of the momentum of our bottle, so we'll use a B subscript, and the momentum of our water, a W subscript. Now also recall that these P's we're using here mean momentum, which is mass times velocity. So we can write the momentum of our bottle as the mass of the bottle times the velocity of the bottle. And we can write the momentum of our water as the mass of the water times the velocity of the water. All right, so that equation is what we're going to use here to solve for the velocity of the bottle. Let's now list the variables that we know. Well, we have the mass of the water, and we know that's 1.2 kilograms. Similarly, we have the mass of the bottle, and we know that's 0.25 kilograms. We know the velocity of the water shooting out the bottom is 2.2 meters per second. Now, that's shooting downwards, so we're going to mark it with a negative. And then what we want to know is the velocity of our bottle. That's what we don't know yet. So our third segment over here is going to be actually using our equation now. We know that 0 is equal to the mass of the bottle, 0.25, times the velocity of our bottle. That's what we don't know. That's going to be VB. And then we're going to add to that the mass of the water shooting out, which is 1.2, times the velocity of the water, which we know is negative 2.2. All right, so we can simplify that equation a little bit and we'll get 0 equals 0.25 velocity of the bottle minus now 2.64. We can go ahead and add 2.64 to both sides and we'll get 2.64 equals 0.25 the velocity of the bottle. Last step here to solve for the velocity of this bottle is to divide both sides by 0.25. And that'll give us just the velocity of the bottle on the right there. And 2.64 divided by 0.25 gives us 10.56. Now, we do one around for sig figs, and our mass of our water has just 1, 2 sig figs, and that's the fewest sig figs that we have. So we're gonna round to 2 sig figs. We wanna keep the first two numbers. That 5 there will make us round up to 11, and the units will be meters per second. That's gonna be equal to the velocity of our bottle. So our bottle is gonna go upwards at 11 meters per second. All right, now it's your turn. This problem says a 62 kilogram woman at rest holds a 0.5 kilogram snowball on a frictionless plane of ice. So we're ignoring friction. What is the woman's backwards velocity after she throws the snowball forward at 11 meters per second? So the snowball is going forward. That's going to push the woman backwards. Go ahead and pause the video and see if you can solve this problem. All right, did you get it? Let's take a look at the solution. We started with conservation of momentum, knowing that the initial momentum and final momentum had to both be zero, and that the final momentum was equal to the momentum of the woman and the snowball added together, which ultimately let us solve for the velocity of the woman as 0.09 meters per second backwards. If you weren't able to get that, pause that and take a look at these steps and compare them to the steps on your own paper until you can sort out how to get this problem done. Keep working at this. I know it's tough stuff, and we're going to work through many more problems that are pretty similar in upcoming lessons. Let's review what we've learned. First, we reviewed the properties of momentum. Most importantly, we saw that momentum is conserved, which means that the initial and final momentum have to be the same during a collision or during propulsion. Then we applied conservation of momentum to a collision. And lastly, we applied conservation of momentum to propulsion. Hey, hey.